Hello, my name is David Faure and I work for KDAB. In this video, I will show you how to use a secondary thread in order to be able to implement blocking communication over a socket. This is basically an alternative implementation of the same protocol as the one we saw in the last video, except this one will use blocking calls. So the server doesn't change at all. All of the changes we are going to make are on the client code. Basically, what we want to do is to be able to implement the protocol in the way showed here. We want to be able to send a command, wait for the response, then read the response. And once we have it and we have passed for the matches, we extract the country names. And then we want to be able to say, for each country, get me the flag name, wait for the response and treat it. So this way we have all of the logic in a single method and the protocol could be as complex as it is, maybe a lot more complex than this, and we would still be able to implement it with for loops and all sorts of other classic ways of implementing algorithms. But to be able to do that, we'll have to use a secondary thread so that we don't block the main thread. And if you're not convinced about that, you can see part two of this series where I show the problems with doing that. All right, so what does that look like? In this diagram, I'm showing you how the inter-thread communication will look like. In the main thread, we'll still have the connection class to implement the communication, but it will delegate that to a secondary thread. So it will create what we call a worker and put that into a Qthread so that the code of that worker is running a secondary thread. It will deal with the socket, so it will have all the code around the socket. And the only ways of communicating between the connection class and the worker class are going to be invoke methods, when we want to actually invoke methods in the worker, and signals for any replies from the worker, any notification it wants to send us. So that's what the diagram is. Let's have a look at the actual code for it. So in this connection class, what we'll do is create the Qthread instance that we do here with new Qthread, and we create the worker. And what we are going to do is to use the moveToThread method to move the worker to that secondary thread. If you don't know what moveToThread really does, you can watch another video that I did in the Multithreading with Qt series, part 6. I explain everything about signals and slots to communicate between threads. And speaking about signals, what we do here from the worker is connect to the three signals that it has for us: connected, match fetched, and country flag fetched. So this is how we get the responses. And this time, when the GUI asks us to connect to the server or to send a command, we'll do that by simply delegating to the worker, which we do with the invoke method. And this way we call the connect to server method in the worker, but not in the current thread executing this method here, connect to server, that's the main thread. Instead of that, it will be invoked in the secondary thread because that's where all of the event handling for the worker happens. And this way we don't block the main thread. If we have a look at the worker itself, when we ask it to, for instance, send the command for the get matches, it prepares the JSON request, sends it, and then it can do wait for ready read so that it blocks until the response comes in. And that makes this code a lot easier. We simply create the command, wait for the response, and then we can process it as usual by going through the matches, collecting the country names. And then what we can do with these country names is we can query for those in an actual for loop, which is a lot easier than having a list of pending requests and processing them one at a time. Here we can just go ahead and make blocking calls, iterating in that loop. We create the get flag name command and then send it and wait for the response before we process the response. So all of that allows us to implement this more easily, and we can block because this is all done in a secondary thread. So that's it. Thank you for watching this video. In the next video, I will show you an alternative protocol for doing this kind of inter-process communication called DBus. It's a standard communication protocol, especially on Unix, that we can use instead of basically coming up with our own protocol as we did here with JSON. It could have been anything else, of course. You know, we could have used XML or plain text or binary format. All of that makes no difference to the socket code. I hope you enjoyed this series about interprocess communication, and see you soon about DBus. Bye-bye.